Good afternoon, everyone. Well, we've got one case set for argument at 1:30 today, and that's In re Philip Metchan. Christina Shays, the debtor, versus Hoffman. When you're ready, counsel.
Good afternoon. I please the court. I'm Andrew J. Christensen, appearing for appellant Christina Shay, the creditor. In our brief, we laid out the reasons why the Supreme Court and this court's prior rulings about exclusive jurisdiction of bankruptcy courts makes it so the abstention order.
What about 11 U.S.C. 1334D?
What about it?
Do we have jurisdiction? Do we, the Ninth Circuit?
It says any decision to abstain or not to abstain made under subsection C is not revealable by appeal or otherwise by the Court of Appeals.
I think we do because the abstention was.
Did you consider that statute?
Yes, I did. And I can't remember what I can't remember the answer to your question right now. But we did consider that before appealing, and there is case law that says that that it is an appealable order in this particular case.
What is that case law?
Well, you could appeal it to the district court, as you did.
We did. I believe it is.
Yeah, if you have a case saying that we, the Court of Appeals, has jurisdiction despite subsection D, you can provide that cite.
I believe I do. I apologize, I'm not prepared for that. It's 28 U.S.C. 158A. And the basis of jurisdiction for this court to hear it is 28 U.S.C. 158D and Federal Rule of Appellate Procedure 6B.
If authority.
Yeah. Generally, to the extent we have jurisdiction, I think it would be under 158. But the problem is this statutory language in 1334 is pretty clear. We can't reach a decision to abstain.
Do you have case authority to support you?
You know, I know I do somewhere, and I'm looking for where that is. If I cannot find it here, I would.
In your briefs, you seem to rely on a couple of cases just before the United States got into World War II, Pepper v. Litton and Thompson v. Magnolia.
Yes.
Petroleum, are those your authority of which you're speaking?
They could be because Pepper v. Litton was about a proof of claim also and exclusive jurisdiction over claims. Because this is a jurisdictional issue. It's not, I mean, this is primarily should be treated as a jurisdictional issue, that there is no authority for a lower court to abstain, or bankruptcy court, excuse me, from exclusive jurisdiction. So.
But any decision to abstain is not reviewable by the Court of Appeals under Section 158D. So despite 158D, we don't have jurisdiction to take up a decision to abstain. That's what it means to me. So I want to hear your best argument on that statutory language.
I'm sorry I'm not prepared to answer that question today. I did look into that before we made the decision to appeal, and that was resolved in my mind, but I was not prepared to address that today.
All right. Well, you can save some time and mull it over, and we can hear from Ms. Barnier if you wish.
Okay.
Same question.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. Jean Barnier for the trustee, Timothy W. Hoffman. And I only wish I had thought about it as clearly, because, of course, we are raised in the bankruptcy court, that you all have jurisdiction over every bankruptcy court order, which is how I approached it. I also believe in this particular matter, because it is an interlocutory order and not a final order, the court might find that it has jurisdiction. But if this court is so inclined that it does not have jurisdiction, I don't want to waste any further time of this court. And I would sit down at this point. I have other arguments that I would make, but I don't see any reason to waste the court's time if this court's going to base its decision on one.
We have one thing I want you to address, because it bothers me intensely, and I'm going to raise it with your opposing counsel. And that is the whole wastage of the estate. This is a divorced woman who didn't have much there to start. And it looks to me like the way this case is developing, or at least the way counsel, your counsel on the other side wants it to develop, is all the entire estate goes to pay attorney's fees. Doesn't that bother you?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, when we came to terms of settlement, the terms were terms the trustee could not accept, given his duty. There were attempts to settle on numerous occasions, starting from the very beginning when the property was sold. I do not, despite the court's inference, it is my personal opinion, based on Ms. Shea's ability to refi her house and obtain quite a bit of money, she has other sources of money. So I don't believe this is a case where the $14,000 is critical to her. If it was, Your Honor, I would have believed that they would have agreed more readily to settle, which we did try, and as you know, the judge did. We did have to try the priority claim. We did not have a choice as to that, because under the bankruptcy code, only the bankruptcy court can rule on a priority claim. The remainder of it was, to be honest,
I'm opposing counsel's taking the position that his attorney's fees will become the priority claim.
Oh, that they will be included in the priority claim? Mm-hmm. First of all, Your Honor, the bankruptcy court vehemently disagreed with that position, as you know. The district court also disagreed with that position. And I believe the irony of it is that would have been the strongest argument to send this back to state court, because, of course, that's what California Superior Courts do, determine attorney's fees if they're justifiable. In my mind, Your Honor, it would be very difficult to justify, and I have no idea what Mr. Christensen's fees are at this point. I can already tell you right now, I am working for free. I am not going to get paid for all the work that our firm has put into this. But it's hard to believe that any court would find that Mr. Christensen's work to obtain $14,000 for his client would justify legal fees in much more of that amount. Furthermore, the case that Mr. Christensen relies on, INRI STNL, is clearly distinguishable. And in that matter, it was a contract dispute that had been resolved before the bankruptcy was entered. So you then have to go back to the state court provisions for fees from attorneys, which is a lengthy hearing, to my understanding. I don't practice in that area, but under the code, and I believe as the district court outlined, district court found it very unlikely that Mr. Christensen would obtain his fees. And it's difficult because we have not had the claim modified at all, so we even know to do it. Would I love to have this case wrapped up and done? So would the trustee, because it's such a minor amount of money that we even started with to drag this out to this point.
Thank you.
Subsequent to the decision in this case, have state court proceedings been initiated or reinitiated?
I have no knowledge of that, Your Honor. I do not know.
Thank you.
I do have 5 minutes and 30 seconds, so I guess I will reserve that time if another issue comes up, but I don't believe it will be necessary.
Your Honor, I was not able to find in my notes where I have the authority to answer your question, but if you continue this matter to the end of the calendar, I can find that. to answer that question if you'd like. The one answer I do have to that, though, is that part of the order here is to send. So one of the reasons this order is unusual is because it is not abstaining from liquidating the amount of a proof of claim. It is sending bankruptcy estate funds to the state court. That's not part of abstention. That part of the order is should not be considered an abstention. It's an express affirmative order to turn bankruptcy court funds over to the state court. And there's no jurisdiction to do that. That violates their exclusive jurisdiction. So that's not technically abstaining. Abstaining is only refusing to rule on something. But there's three parts of the order that are appealed here. One is the abstention. The second part is sending the money to the state court. And the third part is ordering the trustee to close the estate and pay claims before the claims are final. So those two of the three parts of that order are appealable, and they're not abstention. So if the court would like, I can continue arguing, or we could pause, and I could find that authority to answer
your
question.
Well, if you do find something that's directly on point, why don't you go ahead and file a letter submission with the court?
Sure.
Anything further to add to your argument today?
I'm going to let you address what I raised with your opposing counsel, and that is, it seems to me, you know, in the blue brief, you can see that the bankruptcy court, I'm quoting you, correctly observed that the estate does not have the money to litigate this claim. Explain to me how litigating these appeals to the district court and then to us is in Shea's best interest.
The first reason is the distinction between the trustee has an affirmative duty to minimize the cost of litigating claims. They cannot exceed in their fees the value that they get back. That's an affirmative fiduciary duty the trustee has. Creditors, and my client does not have the same duty. She can pursue collection of the amount owed to her for the domestic support obligation, and to the fullest extent that she's able to recover that. She needs this money to survive. And because one side decides to make unreasonably expensive litigation does not bear on my client's, she has no duty to minimize that. And in other words, my client does not have a duty to give up her claim.
Don't you have a duty?
I have a duty to my client. No, I have no duty to the estate or to other creditors. But the real reason this is important is because this claim and the attorney fees incurred are non-dischargeable. So my client is unable to recover those fees from the debtor himself after the bankruptcy case is over. So whether or not my client's entire claim gets paid by the bankruptcy funds is not the end of my client's case. She will get the rest of that money from the debtor after the case is over.
Through the state court.
Yes, she can collect it directly through state court collection means after the bankruptcy case is over. So her entire claim is non-dischargeable. So it doesn't. So she's fighting for her life here, Your Honor. She's starving. She can't make her payments. I mean, she's having a hard time, and she's not going to give up because the trustee has began ill-advised litigation and spent too much money. The trustee's duty, when it becomes this point, there's lots of case law on this, when the amount of money it costs the estate to pursue claims exceeds the potential recovery, the trustee's affirmative duty is to stop and abandon those claims. That's what all the cases are. So that brings us to another point, which is what I want to focus on, is the harm that's caused here by this abstention order. Because in this case, it was not an abstention of an entire proceeding, only half of a proceeding. So the bankruptcy court ruled on three out of the six parts of the claim. That interlocutory order is not appealable at the time. And the question is now, is it appealable? It's not clear whether that's now final retroactively or when it can be appealed or if it can be appealed. And it's a reversible order. It's my client, for many reasons. Anyway, so it leaves us in this limbo where we don't know what can be appealed and what can't. And the same problem is if my client goes to state court and gets a ruling there. There's no unified ruling about the amount that she's owed, no unified place to appeal of any kind. And also, the debtor, who will be the party litigating in state court, is an entirely different party from the trustee, who will argue that the state court order allowing this money is void because it's not just liquidating the claim, it's allowing a proof of claim in state court, and that order is void. And so we'll have spent all the money and time to do that, then it's declared void, and we have to go back or we would get stuck. There's no recourse in bankruptcy court, no recourse in state court. My client gets left with no ability to enforce the amount that's owed to her. And then the last major harm is that when my client does amend the proof of claim shortly after this matter to add her fees that she's allowed to under the SNTL Corp case, under this binding authority, bankruptcy courts do it all the time, that is a priority claim. And that is entitled to take all the money in front of the other creditor. So it will greatly affect the distribution of the estate. And the problem that it brings is that now also there is no final adjudication of an allowed proof of claim in the bankruptcy court because half the claims in state court, half the claims here. So those are the main points of harm as to why abstention is so important to reverse in this case.
All right. Thank you very much, counsel, for your argument. Just so that there's no uncertainty, if you have a case that's helpful to your side from your prior research, go ahead and file it by 5 o'clock tonight.
Thank you, Your
Honor. Thank you. We'll be in recess until 2 o'clock.